It's funny. People always be like, don't forget about the little people. It's like, why do they refer themselves as little anyway, you know? Why don't you just get big with me? Feel me? They can see it in my eyes.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of John's Entitled Podcast, a partner of MoshPitNation.com. This week's guest is James Hart of 18 Visions. You may also remember him from his time spent in Burn Halo after 18 Visions called it a day the first time. This interview actually came about while I was out in LA about a month ago, and it was super nice of James to actually take the time to talk to me a little bit. Dude was super busy, as I ended up finding out. When I met up with James, he actually was doing merch and kind of doing a lot of the different ins and outs of being in a touring band on their own, just to kind of, you know, make it easier on the band itself, not having a million people come out with them. They were doing a weekend run of shows out on the West Coast, and the Roxy was, I believe, the last one of those three dates. It was pretty interesting, actually, to finally see 18 Visions, a band my wife and I have liked for a long time. Interestingly enough, I was really into the band when, like, until The Ink Runs Out and, like, Vanity and stuff like that had kind of come out. More of kind of the traditional hardcore sound that a lot of my friends who were into that style were into at the time. Whereas seemingly my wife got into the band around the time of, like, the self-titled record, maybe around Vanity as well. I'm kind of trying to remember some of the records that she listens to more out of that band. But I know when I ended up buying Until the Ink Runs Out for her on vinyl and played it, she was not too stoked on that and was like, what is this? But it was kind of cool to be able to go to the show. Interestingly enough, you know, I've never been out to the West Coast, and my wife had only been once, and I don't remember exactly where she said it was. But it was weird kind of being in Hollywood, literally on the Sunset Strip is where we were staying. And, you know, being from the East Coast originally and now living in the Midwest, it's very weird to go somewhere where people don't seemingly get up until 10 or 11. The city, like, you know, we were still on our 3 hours time difference body clock. But it was weird to get up at, you know, 7 o'clock in the morning and nothing's really happening and places aren't open, and it's just very weird. Especially when all you hear about is how busy LA is and all that kind of stuff. It was really pretty, a lot of the places we went to. But just like anywhere, you know, you can kind of take a turn down a different road, and you're kind of in a little bit of a sketchy area. But overall, the trip was really cool. The first night we got in, we went to the Viper Room, which I definitely will say is, like, I remember kind of getting in there, and I was like, this is it. But it was cool. Ended up seeing some bands that were on tour, like smaller bands. It was kind of outrageous how much I paid to get in to see said bands, considering if I were to go see that show probably anywhere else, it would maybe be a $5 to $8 show, not $15 each. But regardless, it was really interesting just kind of looking around and kind of taking in the vibe of the place and getting a sense of, like, the history of, you know, this is where, you know, bands from the 80s that I love and grew up listening to, this is where they played. And this is still kind of that thing of, like, this is a room that means something. In a day and age where a lot of older venues are kind of going under and so forth, like, there aren't many places that have that history anymore of what the place used to be, and just kind of like, man, so many great, amazing bands have you know, cut their teeth playing in this room. Especially in a day and age, you know, where a lot of that kind of goes away, like, you know, the grunginess of a place being sort of a dive bar. And I really enjoyed the fact that it hasn't lost any of that and kind of actually really prides itself on still being that place. Those are kind of my bars anyway. And so I think if I were to live out there, I don't know necessarily that I would pay $15 to go see bands every night of the week or whatever. But I think I would definitely probably frequent it as just a bar. You know, they're playing really great music over the PA as the bands were getting ready. Shit like Blindside and just all kinds of stuff from, like, when I was growing up. So I really enjoyed that. And whoever the sound dude was playing all that shit, like, kudos to you. I fucking thoroughly enjoyed it. I have the soundtrack to drinking my whiskey and PBR. The other thing, too, that was kind of interesting about the trip out to L.A. was, you know, just kind of going down the Sunset Strip and just kind of going to see some of these other venues. You know, I didn't get to go to the Whiskey, but I passed it. We obviously went to the Roxy. And what was interesting, too, about on my way to go to do this interview was the fact that I ended up seeing so many people before the show that were, like, you know, industry people. Like, I saw Zach Cannon, who did sound for 18 Visions that night, but also has done sound for The Used, has done sound for Every Time I Die. That's how I know who Zach is, because he was in all those Every Time I Die DVDs from forever ago. But the dude, you know, any sound that I've ever seen him do just always sounds really fucking good. And it's one of those, like, where you see how goofy he can be and all that kind of stuff and follow him on Twitter and so forth. Like, it, you kind of forget that the guy is a professional and what he does. So it was really kind of cool to see him, you know, basically randomly. I didn't know he was going to be doing sound for 18 Visions, so that was kind of a neat little surprise. And I even was like, hey, Zach. And then I kind of remembered, I was like, oh, yeah, you don't know who I am, which is kind of weird when you watch, like, band documentary DVDs as much as you do, is you feel like you know these people and are like a weird friend of sorts to them, and they don't know who the fuck you are. So it's always kind of funny to be like, oh, yeah, I got to remember that they don't know who I am. James, though, couldn't have been nicer. Like, you know, we didn't get a ton of time together, but I feel like we were able to pack quite a bit into the 20-ish minutes or so that we were able to talk. And, I mean, just the fact that he honestly didn't have to do any of this, but the fact that he did and he was so gracious with his time and so forth was really cool. James is someone that I've actually wanted to get on the podcast for a while, and then, interestingly enough, 18 Visions rolled out with a new record and so on and so forth, because I really wanted to talk to him about what I ended up talking to him about, was his job being a hairstylist and going through cosmetology school at a time where a lot of people really weren't, as far as, like, men, and especially, you know, men in the hardcore scene as well. So it was kind of cool to be able to talk to James, as I've mentioned him a couple of times on this podcast in that regard. And while it may not be an interview a lot of people really dig, because it's not about the band, it's not about band stuff, I think it was really cool to kind of talk to him about something that he probably doesn't get asked a whole lot about for an entire interview. The few interviews that I had been listening to leading up to the one that we ended up having, it's like a very, like, if the interview is an hour, he only gets to talk about this thing for, like, maybe, like, one question. So it's definitely something that I've wanted to kind of pick his brain about a little bit. Cosmetology and hairstyling as a whole is actually a career that I've wanted to go into for a long time. I just don't. It's an oversaturated market where I live. A ton of people go into it, and I always just feel like, you know, with the oversaturation of people who are into it, that it might be a lot harder to find a job and kind of carve out a career in it. So I've kind of been leery of going down that road, but a lot of my friends actually have been going into that realm and seemingly are having a lot of fun and finding a lot of reward in the process of going through the schooling and then subsequently getting a job at a, you know, a salon or a barbershop or something. And I don't know, it's kind of got me wanting to go and do it again, like, kind of want to look into going to school. I mean, at 33, is do I really want to go down another path and try to find a new career and start doing something all over from scratch, or just kind of, you know, do what I'm doing now? I don't know, but It's something that I've definitely thought about doing for a long time, and getting to talk to James, who is one of the people that kind of got me interested in wanting to do hairstyling and so forth, and seeing how it can correlate into my passion of, like, hardcore and music in general, into just, you know, kind of wanting to be a creative person in that realm. It was really cool. Interestingly enough, too, about the 18 Visions show was Davey Havoc was there from AFI, and a slew of other bands at this point. And while initially I didn't understand why he was there, it suddenly occurred to me that during the show that he basically was in a band, a new straight edge band called Extremist. And the guitar player for 18 Visions is the guitar player of that band as well. And so, kind of putting it all together, it was like, oh, okay, yeah, this all makes sense. And you know, they probably, 18 Visions and the dudes in AFI probably were friends way back in the day. So it was just kind of like one of those weird things where my wife and I were like, I think that's Davey Havoc. And then I realized it really was when I almost caught a swinging like arms from Davey while he was moshing during the show. I may have mentioned that at a different point, but I'm not entirely sure. But I don't think many people at this in this day and age, unless you were at that show, can probably say you almost got hit in the face by Davey Havoc while he was moshing to 18 Visions' Tower of Snakes. So that was pretty much the capper to our LA trip, and definitely was one of those where I was like, well, I guess, you know, we saw the band, I did the podcast, and that happened. So it was kind of a trip to have that happen and kind of be the ending of our trip out to LA. Also ran into Doc Coyle of Bad Wolves, who I will actually, as of the day I'm recording this intro, we are going to finally be doing our podcast in a few hours. So it was kind of cool actually getting to meet him in person and talk to him a little bit, and kind of, you know, he was telling me some of the people he's got coming up on the podcast and so forth. And it was just kind of really cool. Doc couldn't have been nicer. And I definitely think, you know, his podcast is killing it right now. Like, he just put out an episode with Ken Susie that was fucking great. Everything that dude's doing over on his podcast is great, and I highly recommend going over and checking out his podcast. Very much like myself, he tries to get a wide ranging of guests and going down the rabbit hole of just kind of, you know, industry stuff, you know, behind the scenes people and so forth. And it's just, it's always a great listen. And speaking of great listens, while it may be short, this is my conversation with James Hart of 18 Visions.
I'm not very smart with this shit, so this is the easiest way I can do it.
Right on.
So, I'll just double check, make sure I got everything good.
So what's the podcast all about?
It's basically just people pursuing their passions, really.
Right on.
Like, I called it my Untitled Podcast because I couldn't come up with a clever name. And then the more I thought about it, it's like, I just talked to people about, like when I talked to Mark from Atreyu, I was like, I want to talk to you about your photography and shit like that. So basically your other passion that inspires you.
Cool.
So, like, I kind of realized, like, that's sort of, like, my angle on everything. So, like, when I... Originally, like, I just saw a time hop on my Facebook that said basically, like, how I was talking about you over the last two podcasts I've done, because TJ Miller from Still Remains went to cosmetology school.
Okay.
And then a few other people I've talked to kind of went around the same time you did. So I was like, oh, you know, James is one of the few people I can think of that initially that went to cosmetology school that was in a hardcore band and pursuing that as well as pursuing the music career, like, kind of both at the same time. And it was one of those things for me where I was like, you know, like, I feel like he was kind of the catalyst for that, like, one of the catalysts for that, like, pursuing both passions.
Yeah.
And, I don't know, I just kind of was thinking about that. So, like, when we were doing this, I was like, you know, I think a lot of people have been focusing on you coming back. And I understand that that's a thing, obviously. But it was more like, you know, now you've really been into your other career this whole time. And to me, it's like, I think that's kind of a cooler story. Like, what have you been doing within that career this whole time? And in addition to kind of like seeing like the band thing, like once you left it, like kind of looking at it from a perspective of like not being an active participant. But yeah, so I have James Hart, 18 Visions, expert in Halo with me outside the Roxy. So forgive the background noise if you hear it.
What's up?
And we're going to do a quick chat about James's other profession, or now his main profession, now that the music thing is his other thing at this point.
Yeah.
So, I know you and Javier and even Brandon, way back in the day, ended up doing, getting into cosmetology school. And what's always interesting to me about it is I think, you know, men have always been a pretty heavy force within the cosmetology field. But on the same token, when you guys got into it, I don't feel like there's a lot of men really in that field, especially with the crazy hairstyles that were starting to come out and the change within that field. So what was it like kind of going through that at that time?
Oh, it was cool. I mean, I felt like it was something I kind of wanted to pursue in high school. I started getting into music and metal and hardcore, and I was always into or intrigued by the visual side of music. And,
right.
You know, just the way that bands looked in, you know, the 80s and the early 90s and stuff, and the transitions, and interested in stuff like that. David Bowie, I thought, always had a cool androgynous look that was like always shifting, and there's a lot of 80s artists that were doing that, and I thought it was super cool. I never expected music to turn into a career. It wasn't even necessarily a passion of mine when I was younger. It was just something I sort of fell into. Was doing 18 Visions and then ended up going to cosmetology school with my old bandmate Hav, and you know, finished that up and, you know, started to get my hands into it a little bit for a couple of years. 18 Visions was doing minor touring at the time, and it wasn't until I think 2002, right around 2002 or 2003, we decided to go full time. So I completely left that and then, you know, did the 18V thing and pursued, continued to pursue music with Burn Halo. And then, you know, when I felt like it was finally time for me to, you know, really take a look at my life and what I was doing and, you know, my future, I felt like I needed to step away from music full time and, you know, kind of get back into something more stable. And, you know, being a hairstylist offered me that stability to, you know, build my own clientele, work my own schedule, make some good stable money and build a career for myself and still be able to, you know, kind of do music or pursue other things if I wanted to. I still have that free time, but it was also another way for me to be creative if I wasn't able to do music.
Right. What's always kind of interesting too is I feel like a lot of people, you know, I feel like it's one of the few professions that you can actually kind of take on the road with you. Like, I know it's kind of frowned upon to do sort of like the backyard kind of, you know, hairstyles and so forth once you get like licensed and so forth, but
yeah, so I actually did that for a while with 18 Visions, and I had people reach out to me. A couple people were cool. I, you know, I did some haircuts, and one girl wanted me to color her hair, so I went down to like a Sally Beauty Supply. I think we were in like Louisville, Kentucky, and we were on like a Lamb of God tour.
Okay.
And I went to like a Sally Beauty Supply, and she wanted this double process hair color, which is, you know, you do one process, you wash it out, and then you do another process, you wash that out. So she wanted like some red in her hair with black.
Okay.
So I did the black when I foiled some pieces out, lightened them up, washed it in some ghetto ass sink, and then ended up putting red over it. And we had predetermined like the cost of all this, you know, and my time, especially my free time on the road. And after we were done, she just kind of walked off. I stopped her and I said, hey, so, you know, what about like, you know, paying me for this? We agreed upon a dollar amount. She's like, oh, I don't remember any of that. Sorry, I don't have any money on me. So I ended up paying for the product.
Sucks.
And giving her about 3 hours of my free time on tour, which
that's kind of sparse,
you know, as you know, we all know time is the most precious gift that you can give somebody. So
yeah,
I felt a little gypped. So after that, I kind of stepped away from doing it. And then once I knew that I was most likely going to be coming back into the career in hair, the last couple of Burn Halo tours that I did, I started throwing out the idea of doing haircuts. So I did a few here and there just to kind of get my hands back in it before I went to a salon full time. And that was cool. That worked out all right. But again, it's just, it's not a professional setting. It's not like an ideal situation to work in. And, you know, it's not comfortable for me. It's not comfortable for the client. You can't, you know, you don't have all your tools there. You can't you can't really put 110% into it. So it's a little tough.
Something I've always kind of wondered too, in talking with some of my friends who tattoo and some other musicians who tattoo as well as doing the band thing, is I know that, like, tattoo artists, given kind of the nature of their profession, sort of end up as, like, discount therapists of sorts. So I've kind of wondered if that happens to you even, like, where people just kind of start, like, as you're, like, maybe doing, a 3-hour-long process of coloring hair, just start telling you, like, shit you don't necessarily need to know.
Absolutely, man. I mean, you get some weird stories from, like, certain clients that are, you know, a lot of Yelp clients.
Okay.
That are, I would say 50-50 are like weird and 50% are normal. And the weird ones will come in, they'll sit down in your chair and they're just like super neurotic and they'll dump like deep personal issues and stories on you within the first 10, 15 minutes. Whereas clients that I've had for like the last 5 or 6 years, they're in on a regular basis. You kind of get to know them. You get to know their backstory, their history, their family, and, their hobbies and their careers. But it's a slow build, It's not like, here's my life in 5 minutes, so those kind of clients create a little bit of like an awkwardness, but you just deal with it and battle through it. And then you get to know clients too over, for me over the last 5 or 6 years and, hopefully 5 to 15 years more, however long I continue to do this. And your clients go through some things, they have deaths in the family, they get married, they get divorced, they have children, they change careers.
Right.
There's a lot going on. So you're with somebody for anywhere from 45 minutes to, 3, sometimes 4 hours, depending on what I'm doing with them. And, it's just an opportunity for them to, have a lending ear.
Right. Also, kind of the fun thing to me sort of about your profession now is, and given the fact that, I'm in my almost mid-30s now, and I know you're older than I am, but thinking about how seeing some of these old styles coming back, like, is it kind of a trip for you to, like, see some of these styles, like, maybe even living out here in California, maybe before, like, they make their way out, like, to where I am in the Midwest or whatever, is that kind of a trip to see some of these old styles coming back?
Yeah, well, so, I mean, with hairstyling, like, the trends are constantly shifting and kind of going back to, stuff from the 80s,
right,
but putting like modern twists on it, which is super cool. I mean, some clients are cool with it, some aren't. I like some of it I don't. The biggest thing I've noticed, man, is actually playing and going to shows.
Okay.
And the shift, and it has this total like 90s feel to everything. So for me, a lot of these new bands I'm hearing sound like late 90s hardcore or metalcore, and then stylistically, like visually, I'm seeing longer hair, bigger t-shirts, some bands looking like they could, they're Soundgarden at like 19 years old,
Yeah.
And to me, that's cool because I grew up on that stuff.
Right.
So I like that vibe to me. So it's, it's cool. I just like how fashion and music is just ever changing.
Kind of speaking a little bit to the fashion and music, wouldn't be a California thing without California. speaking to fashion and music, though, everyone kind of tagged you guys as like the originators, I would say, of fashioncore, and I hate fucking subgenres and titles and all that shit, but it is what it is. But the interesting thing to me is with one of you, with you guys being one of the few that kind of got into more of a look, like a look as a band and look as individuals, due to, like I said, three of you going to cosmetology school and so forth, and where you actually had day jobs.
Well, really two of us did.
Well, okay. So. At least the third one went.
A month doesn't count.
Okay. Well, it never has been specified how long he actually went, so I was just giving him benefit of the doubt. But be that as it may, with the two of you actually going through and finishing and the jobs that you guys had leading up to the band, something I kind of always wondered, though, is, like, do you ever felt like it gave you guys more of a bond than maybe the average band? Because not only were you in the band, but you had this other thing that maybe not a lot of people were doing, not only at the time, but just in general, like, another career field that maybe would bond you over, like, man, that gig was awesome, blah, blah, blah. We got this, like, coloring test tomorrow. Like, holy shit, I fucking nailed it. You killed that. Like,
no, I mean, no, I didn't really go through anything like that, to be honest with you. The whole image thing was definitely due to working in the hair industry and, like, going to school. But also, like, while I was going to school, Ken and I worked at Banana Republic.
Right.
So we got nice – first of all, we had to wear some of that clothes to work.
Yeah.
We got a 50% discount on some of these nice clothes. So we just – I'd wear some of that to school and then kind of out and about. I wouldn't change – after work or, before work or whatever, I just kind of wear the same thing all day. And I just, started getting compliments on it, started to feel comfortable
right.
wearing that. And it just kind of evolved and we all just kind of rubbed off on each other with our styles and what we liked. And there was other bands too that influenced us at the time, like Refused and Unbroken. And they were definitely heavy visual like influences on us as people and as a band. But the whole fashion core thing's funny to us because it's something that we never even coined.
No.
And it's something that we used to cringe at, but I mean, now we just think it's funny. So it's like kind of like we 10 years later after breaking up, you know, people are like, oh yeah, fashion core, what did you think of that? And we just like kind of laugh about it. So it's kind of a joke to us.
Right. It's kind of interesting to me though, because interestingly enough, like you grew up in the Midwest in Chicago, and I live now in Michigan, but I'm from the East Coast initially. So we kind of have the same thing, sort of. Like, you grew up in the Midwest and then came out west, or in the Midwest and then came out here to California, whereas I came from East Coast and then here in the Midwest. And just the differences in lifestyle, kind of. Even kind of like a little bit of a culture shock for me coming out here, where everyone's in a hurry to do nothing, as I've kind of learned in the last few days. But I always kind of wondered, like, how much of, like, was it just kind of a interesting transition for you going from the Midwest, like when you did to out here in California? Like, was it as much of a shock kind of as it has been for me just to see how different it is?
I mean, I was 6.
Oh, okay.
When I moved out, so.
You weren't that much older than I was when I moved from Delaware to Michigan, so.
The only difference for me was moving to cold weather to not cold weather.
Right.
So, I mean, that was the only real thing I can remember experiencing was not having to, you know, bundle up and wear like 30 layers to go to school, you know? So
it's weird because there are people wearing like 30 layers here in the last few days I've been here, and I'm just wearing shorts and like a tank top or whatever. And I'm like, why are you getting, like,
yeah,
people look like they're cold.
That's the thing. It's like, it's 65 and it's like time to layer up, you know?
Yeah, that's so weird to me.
And my dad will come out and visit in like February. It's like 65, you know, or gets down into the 50s and he's wearing like, you know, flip flops and shorts and a tank top.
Yeah, I've been like sweating the whole time I'm out here. It's better than the 13 degrees I left when I left Michigan a couple days ago. And kind of wrapping up, you know, you kind of talked about, you know, other bands, you know, that are kind of getting sort of the label of, like, the fashion core thing and so forth. Kind of beyond that, though, like, you know, I can think of a handful of bands, you know, with Cabin from Old Wounds actually kind of going through cosmetology school and stuff like that. Is it kind of cool, like, to see, like, this other, like, generation sort of like, hardcore band people kind of getting into this thing and kind of embracing this thing that you guys kind of started per se, but like kind of are at a point where you're able to look back on and be like, you know, it's kind of cool what they're doing now and taking it like a step further with like kind of like their foot like in the past, like when we were coming out to kind of doing it now and like,
yeah,
all the hair.
Yeah, I think it's great, man. And you know, I'll touch on two notes. Just as a musician, right? Like, you're all about creating something from the music's created from absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? There's no palette, right? You're just, it's just open air, open space. Just, it's a void until you start creating notes or a beat or a vocal, you know, you start spitting something out, right? Hair, there's a little bit of, you know, you see somebody comes in with their hair a certain color or a certain shape or texture, and you're like, okay, this is what I can do with this, right? So there's just two different kind of creative angles working, but still with music, the beauty and the glory is that you are just creating something from nothing, and then you record it, you put it down, and it's there forever, right? And nothing will ever, for me, fully replace that, like, self, like, gratification of, like, being able to do that. Here's a whole different world. It allows me to be creative on a daily basis, and it challenges me to, you know, kind of stay on my toes from client to client. Everyone's different. Everyone has different wants and different needs and, you know, different ideas of what, you know, fashion is and what their image is. And it's rad to be able to kind of, like, cater to that, but also offer new ideas and, you know, help move somebody into something that they never thought that they could wear and make them feel awesome about themselves. It's still being creative on a daily basis, which is also super gratifying to me, and then obviously allows me to build a career and some stability for, you know, my family and myself. And then the other thing where I see the parallels is just the world that, you know, music has turned into with, you know, being accepting and, you know, a place where you can come without judgment and, you know, live in your own skin. And I feel like, you know, the salon community has that as well. We have you know, for, I mean, for a very, very long time, you know, especially when I went to cosmetology school back in, you know, 1999, 2000, it was predominantly, if you were a guy, you know, you were gay.
Right. I mean,
there wasn't a lot of straight guys doing it.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot more straight guys doing it now, you know, but you're in a salon with gay men. And, you know, I work with a few gay men in my salon, and two of them are married. And, you know, talking to them, you know, one of them's 60 years old, and he didn't feel, you know, he's got kids from a marriage with a woman, and he didn't feel comfortable about, you know, coming out and being himself, you know, at the appropriate age, when he, you know, told me that he knew, you know, at a very young age who he was and what he was. And, you know, now in 2018, you know, I have a transgender person working in my salon as well, at a young age, that is comfortable to come out and is afforded the liberty to come out and, you know, feel comfortable in their own skin and, you know, be who they are and what they, you know, what they want to be. And I feel like the music industry offers that as well, you know, at least the hardcore scene. And, you know, the salon industry are just so accepting and welcoming of, you know, all walks of life. And it's, I wish that, the whole, you know, the whole world was as progressive as, you know, both of the industries that I've been a part of.
Yeah. I feel like it's kind of getting there, especially in the last couple of weeks with the sort of Me Too movement going on within the hardcore world, like kind of outing people who have been doing a lot of bad things. We'll say,
right.
Just kind of keep it simple. Kind of wrapping up, last few questions. One unrelated to hair, but I'm excited because when I go to Chicago in a few months, I'm actually going to go see the Braves play the Cubs. I'm going to finally go to Wrigley. How do you feel about the Cubs this year?
Feel great. Just signed Yu Darvish, 6-year contract. So I feel like, you know, it was either him or Arrieta. For me, signing one of those two guys really solidified the rotation. I feel good about the team. Didn't really need to make any changes or upgrades on offense.
Must be nice.
Right? Yeah.
We have the best pitching right now, but I feel like we're going to trade it all away in the next year or two.
You don't have the best pitching, but that's okay.
We have one of the best farm systems right now.
That's great.
Yeah. Well, look, I remember, like, in the heyday when we had Smoltz, Glavin, and, you know, all those guys.
Maddox,
yeah. Like, that was a former Cub.
Yeah.
That was what we kind of, the bread and butter of our team at the time.
Right.
So, I mean, I'm hoping that maybe we can get a solid 3-4 rotation and get back to our dominant pitching years again.
We'll see.
Yeah. One of the last questions.
NL is tough.
Huh?
The National League's tough.
Yeah, it's... I'm still really mad that the last game that Chipper Jones is now going to the Hall of Fame played was, like, that weird, like, fucking ground-out sort of rule. Last at-bat in the playoffs. I was like, motherfucker. But, I mean, being a Lions fan, I'm also used to a lot of disappointment and weird-ass rules. I always end these with a song. So what would you like me to play the episode out to? Could be anything.
Gosh.
Something maybe you've been jamming a lot lately?
Anything at all.
As long as I can find it on YouTube.
Oh, man. Let's go with one of my all-time favorite songs off of my all-time favorite album, Rain When I Die, Alice in Chains.
Okay. And then the actual last question I have. What has been one of your favorite memories in your haircutting career that you still look back on and just kind of inspires you to keep going within that? I know that may be a tough question.
Gosh, yeah, man, it is so tough. I think, for me, it's nothing that I've done behind the chair, per se. It's watching a haircutter, educator for, he was with Vidal Sassoon and Paul Mitchell for a long time. His name's DJ Muldoon. And the way that he teaches and educates haircutting is just so simple and so relatable and understandable that it just... You listen to him talk, and you watch him work, and you watch him teach, and it just motivates you to pick up a pair of shears and start cutting. Yeah.
So inspiration daily, or every time you see him.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's easy. He's got his own salon in San Diego now, and he does consistent education. There's online education. We had him in our salon. You know, they do stuff at the hair shows. Yeah, stuff like that. It's just, for me... it inspires me to pick up some shoes. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I'll let you get back to getting ready for the show tonight. Looking forward to it. First time actually getting to see you. I feel weird saying that as a 33-year-old man.
Hey, not the first.
Looking forward to the show. Thank you again for doing
cool.
this.
Cool. Yeah, absolutely.
So that was my chat with James Hart of 18 Visions. As I said in the intro, I kind of wanted to keep this one in a little bit more of a different realm as far as just trying to talk about James's actual career that he's been doing probably as long now, or maybe a little bit longer as he has for being known for being a band dude. Something I don't think I really mentioned, and it was one of my questions, was I kind of wanted to know, now that the band's back and going, even on a part-time level, maybe what some of his clients who weren't aware of him being from a hardcore band previously, what they thought, you know, when he's like, oh, you know, I'm going to be out for this weekend. I'm going to be playing some shows. And if people are thinking, you know, like, oh, that's nice. Like, you know, you got a band, and don't know to what level that 18 Visions was at, nor probably the style of music that it is. I always find it interesting that people who are kind of soft-spoken and so forth, that, you know, when people hear them in the band setting or just see someone go ape shit live, like that, they're just like, wow, I didn't know you did all that. So I forgot to ask him that, but I think it'd be really interesting to kind of maybe get a different perspective on, maybe how some of his clients who weren't aware of James's past, would feel, or how they've reacted to 18 Visions being back and maybe looking up, him and his style of music. Going to kind of keep this one short as a whole, though, just because this episode was pretty quick, so kind of get in and get out. If you would like to follow James on Instagram or Twitter, you can at Hartagram. That's Hartagram, taken after the logo of one of my favorite bands, him. And I'm still really jealous of people who are able to parlay their name into a Twitter handle or a podcast name, looking at you, Toomey. And so, yeah. But again, that's Instagram and Twitter at Hartagram. And if you would like to follow 18 Visions and keep up with what they're doing, they have been playing sporadic shows here and there. You can follow them. Best way to do it really would probably be just go to 18vofficial.com. If you would like to just follow them on their socials itself, it's 18v_official for Instagram as well as Twitter. Simple enough. If you would like to keep up with Mosh Pit Nation, you can at moshpitnation.com. You can follow them on Facebook at Mosh Pit Nation West, capital MI. Twitter and Instagram are simply Mosh Pit Nation. And if you would like to follow me, you can follow me on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube at John's Entitled Podcast. Tweet at me at John's Entitled Pod. And you can email me at johnsentitledpod@gmail.com. Interestingly enough, since I know a lot of people may not be familiar with the fact that 18 Visions put out a new record, something I wasn't really aware of until I made comment to a few friends that I was actually going out and talking to James and going to see 18 Visions, which was kind of the basis of going to LA, I got a lot of confused looks on people's faces and a lot of like, they're still a band? And so I was like, yeah, dude, they have been a band for about a year now, and they put out a really great comeback record, just, you know, self-titled, basically. And so in addition to playing the song that James wanted me to play out, which was Rain When I Die by Alice in Chains, I'm going to play basically the first track off of their new record, Crucified. When they put out that song, or when I got the album, I should say, and I got that song, I was like, holy fuck, this band is back. With a vengeance. It's a fucking banger of an album opener, and I just honestly can't say enough great things about that record. It was easily in my top albums of the past year. If you want to go back and listen to the Rob Rivera episode I did where I counted down my albums of last year, that was definitely one of them. And I'm hoping that maybe 18 Visions will play out a little bit closer to here in Michigan, even if it's, you know, maybe a Detroit date or a Chicago date or something. And maybe my wife and I can go and make that work and go see them again. If they are playing anywhere around you, please go out and support them. They still put on a great show. The band sounds fucking great live. And it was well worth the wait. It was a great show, and I had a great time seeing it. So if you were and or still are a fan of 18 Visions, go check them out. They are very much back with a vengeance, and I think Crucified is a great example of that. So, without further ado, going to play Alice in Chains, Rain When I Die, followed by 18 Visions, Crucified. Talk to you next week.
were a kid, but you've become a boy.